It's a show about cleaning money, so why do I feel so dirty? Marty Bird has been laundering money for the Navarro cartel in the Ozarks since mid-2017. In a little more than a year, he's gone from humble financial planner to patriarch of the state's most powerful family. But how? Well, we here at Cinematica are gonna chronicle it all in the Ozark timeline. So far. 2007 to 2017. In 2007, Marty and Wendy Bird are living a clean family lifestyle in Chicago. Marty is a successful financial advisor, but he's still extremely frugal and responsible. Wendy loves being a mother to Charlotte and Jonah, but is also eager to return to her work in politics. They discover they're pregnant with a third child, but a tragic car accident results in a miscarriage, and Wendy spirals into a deep depression. Marty and his partner Bruce are approached by a mysterious Del Rio, who wants the duo to inspect his company's finances. Marty detects that someone has been skimming off the top, thus passing Del's test. But Marty also picks up on some fishy illegal cartel business and initially declines to take on the client. Though when Marty talks to Wendy about the situation, she's surprisingly supportive of a life of crime, and Marty sees the dollar signs. So Marty and Bruce officially partner with Del to launder Omar Navarro's drug cartel money. It sounds glamorous, but things get pretty real when Del murders and rips the eyes out of his old financial planner. That guy was the one skimming off the top and a potential FBI informant. No problem, guys. Just don't steal and don't be a rat. Right, Bruce? Right? Meanwhile, Roy Petty is a level-headed FBI agent eager to rise the bureau ranks. He's in a healthy relationship and he loves his mama. Unfortunately, his mother suffers a nasty fall, gets prescribed heavy painkillers, and becomes horrifically addicted to opiates. She eventually turns to heroin and will do anything for a fix, even betray her own son. Around 2014, Bruce begins stealing $8 million from Navarro with the help of the Hansen Father and Son Trucking Company, while simultaneously acting as an informant for the feds. Really, dude? Marty somehow doesn't notice, even though he's so wrapped up in his work that he's kind of ignoring his family. Wendy feels neglected, so she starts having an affair with Gary Silverberg, aka Sugarwood. Ew. Summer, 2017. Marty becomes suspicious of Wendy's odd behavior, so he hires a private investigator who captures some graphic video evidence. Not the best timing, because Del decides to test his financial advisors by cornering them in the Hansen office and accusing them of skimming. They're baseless accusations, but Bruce's silence paints his guilt. Plus, Hansen Jr. totally cracks. Del executes everyone involved and sets his gun on Marty. But when Del reveals he plans to murder Wendy, Marty gets desperate. Bruce had given him a brochure for the Ozarks, a rich tourist getaway in Missouri with more coastline than the whole state of California. And according to a rambling, bluffing Marty, it's the perfect place for money laundering. He guarantees $500 million of clean cash within 5 years. Del's amused, so he gives Marty mere days to prove it and relocate to the supposed haven, after recovering the stolen $8 million. As Marty scrambles to liquidate all of his assets to pull this cash exchange off, a freaked out Wendy flees to Gary. She withdraws the marital funds before Marty can get to them, but the cartel catches on and intercepts, throwing Sugarwood off his high-rise balcony. Marty barely scrapes the cash together in time, only for Del to explain that Mr. Bird has only until the end of the summer to successfully launder this massive sum of $8 million. Marty hits the Ozarks acting as an angel investor, looking for naive businesses he can exploit for laundering. But the local businesses don't trust random outsiders with money. Bobby, the manager of local strip club Lickety Splits, even catches on to Marty's illegal schemes. Wendy goes house hunting, eventually discovering a cheap option with a strange caveat. Buddy Diker. He's a lovable curmudgeon living in the basement, set to die within a year or so. While mom and dad are busy, the kids are tasked with watching the motel room housing the 8 mil. But the Langmores, a trailer-residing family with a long history of crime, are there to stir up some trouble. Wyatt Langmore convinces Charlotte to go boating while wide-eyed Jonah goes on a walk. Cousin Ruth then breaks into the bird room and steals one-third of the loot. Marty chases her and tracks the whole Langmore clan to a public bathroom. He uses logical reasoning to scare them into returning the cartel cash. Ruth still wants to murder Marty, but she gets overruled by the more peaceful Wyatt and his father Russ. Marty avoids suicide when he discovers the Blue Cat Lodge, a perfect opportunity to launder money with 4th of July business rapidly approaching. He impresses the Blue Cat's owner Rachel by getting punched out while defending her employee. So that's his in. Things finally start looking up, until Wendy reveals the truth of the family dealings to the kids. Oh, and with Bruce having been an FBI informant and all, agents Petty and Evers are hot on Marty's trail. tailing him to the Ozarks. Wendy starts a new job as a realtor so she can launder money by flipping houses and manipulating their real estate agent, Sam. Marty sees past Ruth's murderous intentions and actually gives her a job. He's desperate for new business opportunities and hasn't given up on that strip club. After getting the financial records from a stripper, Marty learns the lickety-splits isn't in Bobby's name, and stealing the deed from the club safe would essentially transfer ownership. To help Marty steal it, Ruth unleashes teenage boys in the club and gets Bobby arrested as the ultimate distraction. But Bobby loses more than his club. His business was already laundering money for the Snells, a local family of heroin manufacturers. Jacob and Darlene Snell brutally murder Bobby via neck-injected overdose and leave his body on the Bird property as a warning. Meanwhile, Petty's working undercover and sees an opportunity to get to Marty through the Langmores, specifically Russ. Russ was arrested 10 years prior for picking up a male prostitute. Petty begins to befriend and seduce this closeted backwoods bear, leading to a secret relationship. As for the kids, well, Charlotte is moping around and Jonah is disemboweling dead animals to study vultures. Charlotte flirts with manipulative college boys and befriends Wyatt while Jonah learns to shoot with his new best friend, Buddy. After stumbling upon Mason Young preaching from his boat on the lake, Marty has a new scheme in mind. Construction costs for a fancy new church on land can hide tons of cash flow. Problem is, the Snells have been using this faux water church to discreetly distribute their heroin via hymnals, all unbeknownst to Mason. The Snells rough Marty up and he insists the church for the young preacher will never be completed. Ruth visits her incarcerated father, Cade. Dude is a total nutcase and insists that she murder Marty, so she rigs Marty's dock to electrocute him, but Petty gets tipped off by Russ and intercepts. This Labor Day weekend only gets worse when Rachel finally takes a good look at the Blue Cat books and calls Marty on his shit. Also, Pastor Mason independently continues construction on the church, endangering Marty. The Snells and Marty rat each other's business out to Mason, who hesitantly agrees to preach back on the water, but begins to have a crisis of faith. To make things even more stressful, Charlotte runs away on the first day of school. Meanwhile, Marty tricks Sam's mother into investing her entire life savings with him. Boom. That's an easy $10 million right there at their disposal, even if this leads to a fight between mother and son. The fight results in Ma walking out into traffic and getting flattened, so Sam wants tons of the money back for her lucrative funeral. Well, Wendy purchases the funeral home after seeing such a profitable business model. It's also pretty damn convenient for getting rid of bodies down the line. Petty reveals his true intentions to Russ, blackmailing his lover with evidence to conspire to murder Marty. He forces Russ into wearing a wire around Ruth. If Petty can get Ruth, he can get Marty. Marty convinces Rachel to let him finish laundering for the last week of the season, and by the end of summer, the $8 million is finally clean. So, naturally, Navarro's goon Garcia shows up with $50 million more to launder. Russ tries to wrangle a confession out of Ruth on tape, but she gets suspicious and isn't biting. Desperate, Russ decides to murder Marty for his money with some help from his brother Boyd. But Ruth's grown a lot more loyal to Marty, so she rigs the Blue Cat dock and electrocutes her own uncles to death. Mason's guilty about indirectly peddling drugs, so the next day, he refuses to preach on the water. Well, the Snells brutally murder his wife and cut out their miraculously alive baby. Marty rushes to meet the Snells and tells his family to skip town, but Garcia sticks around after the suspicious electrocution and interrupts the Bird's exodus. Jonah tries to shoot Garcia, but Buddy removed his bullets. Thankfully, the old veteran takes care of the goon himself. The situation is now completely screwed, so Wendy, Jonah, and Charlotte head to Chicago to acquire new identities. Rachel's thoroughly freaked by the double murder on her property, so she steals a few stacks and skips town too. Unfortunately, she gets Petty's attention in the process. Dell arrives to investigate the shenanigans. After losing a couple of toenails, Marty decides his only chance of survival is to get the cartel and the Snells to work together in a lucrative deal that neither can turn down. With Mason gone, the cartel will buy and distribute the Snells' heroin. In return, the Snells will connect their land to the Missouri River so they can build a casino, the ultimate money laundering opportunity. It's a win for everyone, until Dell calls the Snells rednecks and Darlene blows his brains out. Now the cartel will really be pissed. Marty tells his family to keep running from the white-hot situation, but they refuse to abandon Dad and return to Missouri, ready to face the consequences together as a family. Fall, 2017. The cartel shows up to inquire about Del Rio, headed by the stone-cold lawyer, Helen Pierce. The Snells try to cover up the murder with Ash, their son, nephew, both? I don't know, it depends on what theories you believe. But either way, Ash uses Dell's credit card in Chi-Town, but Helen gets her hands on the footage of said identity theft. Lucky for the Snells, the cartel is still interested in a casino deal, but they demand payback for Dell's murder. So Jacob complies and kills Ash, devastating Darlene. While that's going down, the Byrds begin to play politics. See, Missouri has a hard limit on casinos, and Wendy will need state legislative approval to build an additional one. Politics in Missouri run through one very wealthy conservative, Charles Wilkes. Wendy quickly entrances Charles with her political acumen, charms him, and assures his financial benefit if the casino gets built. Meanwhile, Kay leverages the deaths of his brothers to get released on parole. Ruth is thrilled, but this abusive father is chomping at the bit to rob or murder Marty. To make matters worse, the Kansas City mob then terrorizes the casino's building operations. Miraculously, Buddy is extremely well-connected from his Detroit Teamsters days, and knows the head of the KC mob, Frank. Hell, he may have even slept with his wife. So, Marty agrees to only hire union mafia employees for the casino construction. Wendy does whatever she can to gain votes for the casino, like blackmailing a senator with a lickety-split stripper. Despite Wendy rejecting his sexual advances, Charles swings the final vote by threatening to reveal Senator Blake's clinical depression to the media. The plan works, but Blake commits suicide in his office. Wendy is able to convince his widow not to pursue a wrongful death case, but this won't be the last time blood is on her hands. Charlotte and Jonah haven't been keeping their hands clean either. They jack 10 grand from the 50 million stash. Charlotte just smokes weed with Wyatt, who blames Marty for the death of his father. Jonah is far more productive though. He uses his false identity to open up a bank account to launder money through offshore accounts. Aw, like father like son. But poor Rachel has it the worst. She's shaken up from losing, you know, everything, and goes on a bit of a bender before getting on a felonious wreck. Petty tracks her down and harshly manipulates her to work undercover with a wire. He even goes so far as to get her hooked on opiates. Naturally, the Byrds don't trust Rachel's sudden reappearance. But after blowing Petty's cover and nearly getting murdered for it, Rachel does manage to get Ruth to admit that Marty does some of his laundering at home. That's all the FBI needs for a search warrant to raid the Byrd household. All they find is Charlotte's cartel cash. Charlotte. But that's enough to further question and investigate. With all the smoke, the cartel shows back up to protect their interests. Petty takes advantage, approaching Ruth to make her look like an informant. Now, the feds are all primed to investigate the Snell farm. Helen insists they burn the incriminating opium poppies, but the stubborn locals flat out refuse. While the cartel is busy waterboarding poor Ruth, Wendy and Buddy spring into action. See, Darlene has been obsessed with finding a new baby to replace Ash, so Wendy distracts her with adoption agencies while Buddy burns the opium. Sadly, he dies on the ride home, but boy did he go out with a bang. Unfortunately, the opium fields were also where the Snells buried Mason's wife, among others, so the FBI finds bodies in lieu of opium. No problem. Darlene and Marty dig up a Snell ancestor and use their connections with local Sheriff Nix to swap the bones, so everything in the field seems just like a cheap family grave. The raid was a huge bust, so Petty doubles down his pressure on the increasingly unstable Rachel. Marty is about to incriminate himself to her, but she stops him with a kiss and reveals her wire. She realizes Petty is a madman, and that Marty is her only way out. So, what's Mason Young been up to? Oh, just preaching and rambling out in the cold streets with his newborn Zeke. But once Child Services scoops Zeke up, Mason reaches his absolute breaking point. He loses his religion, kidnaps Wendy, who he blames for the loss of Zeke, and demands Marty return Zeke in exchange for his wife. Marty turns to Charles for help. He doesn't trust the Byrd's shady operations, but he cares enough about Wendy to pull some strings and expedite Zeke's adoption. But even with his baby in tow, Mason still doesn't trust the Byrds and is about to slaughter Wendy anyway. Marty has no choice but to shoot Mason dead. It's Marty's first kill, and it absolutely shatters his moral core. They burn Mason's body and take Zeke home. Darlene is increasingly infuriated by the changes the cartel has brought to the Snell business. She decides to lace a batch of heroin with fentanyl, resulting in the deaths of dozens of users. The cartel retaliates against the Snells in a roadside shooting, and it looks like a war is about to break out. If that isn't messy enough, Charles has completely backed out of supporting the Byrds, and now they'll be unable to acquire the necessary gambling license. So Wendy uses Jonah's fake account to make a massive donation to Charles' charity. Now they can blackmail him for taking cartel money. Marty is also feeling charitable and decides to save Rachel. Oh, what a nice guy. Now all he has to do is track down Petty's mom and pump her full of heroin. The defeated agent requests a transfer back to Chicago to take care of Mrs. Petty. Cade has become increasingly volatile, forcing Ruth to join him on burglaries. They try to steal Marty's money, but it got moved from the funeral home to Buddy's mausoleum. Cade's even more pissed, especially at Ruth, so he robs Lickety Splits to antagonize her, and they have a tense gunpoint standoff over Wyatt's future. If that's not enough family drama, Charlotte wants to get emancipated and spills everything to a lawyer. Then, in the ultimate family drama, Jacob decides to kill Darlene to avoid an unwinnable cartel war, but she beats him to the punch, poisoning his coffee with cherry pits. Now Darlene's in control, and she refuses to allow the casino to be completed before she gets a baby. She even goes so far as to shave Jonah's head to send a message. With no other choice, Marty gives up Zeke's custody to this monster. Cade runs into Petty while the agent is on his way out of town, and Petty makes the mistake of insulting Cade's daughter that he regularly abuses, so Cade brutally beats Petty to death. Ruth refuses to help her father take care of the body, and is ultimately forced by him to tell Wyatt the truth about Russ's death, shattering their relationship. Charlotte's been basically living with Wyatt during this emancipation tantrum, so Cade sees another opportunity to get to Marty. He tries to kidnap Charlotte, but Ruth thankfully saves the day. If killing Petty didn't seal his fate, messing with Wendy Bird's child certainly does. Wendy coughs up $500,000 to have Cade assassinated. Well, that problem solved, but now the KC mob feels neglected by Marty's many political dealings and bomb his office. But hey, at least the new casino, named the Missouri Bell, is open at last. Summer, 2018. About 6 months later, everything is working out pretty smoothly. Going by Ruth's ignored payment history to Wyatt, we're right at the end of July. The casino is a huge success, though Marty is hesitant to start laundering until he's sure the FBI hasn't infiltrated his new staff. He's re-established trust with the mob, who assigned Frank Jr. to oversee operations at the Missouri Bell, which really just equates to the toolbox harassing Ruth. Even Charlotte agrees to stay with the family so long as her parents get some counseling. She never specified that Marty couldn't bribe the therapist to take his side, though. But things aren't going so great for Navarro's cartel. He's losing a bloody war with the rival Laguna's cartel down in Latin America. Apparently, Wendy isn't happy with half a year of relative peace, so she decides to increase the bird's value to Navarro. With their newfound casino business cachet, they can expand legitimately, protecting Navarro's assets for decades in a way that can never be seized by a government. Marty is mortified by the idea. He doesn't want to get any deeper. Hell, he's hoping to run away as soon as the casino can operate without him. Helen pressures Marty to start laundering, and Wendy seizes the opportunity to go over her spouse's head to approach Helen about expansion. Navarro is so intrigued that he meets with Wendy in person to hear her pitch. Meanwhile, Frank Jr. causes a scene at a high-stakes poker game and threatens Ruth, so she tosses him off the casino into the river. The mob is pissed, but everyone agrees to move past the incident so long as both Frank Jr. and Ruth are henceforth respected as untouchable. Poor Ruth has been under a lot of stress, and she's especially worried about her estranged cousin Wyatt. He gets caught breaking into homes, so Darlene breaks him out of jail and sets him to work in her fields as compensation. She even allows him to move onto the property. The birds get a new house guest too, Wendy's brother Ben. He suffers from bipolar disorder and is currently dodging a bench warrant, so he gladly hunkers down in Missouri and takes an immediate liking to Ruth. Helen moves to the Ozarks with her teenage daughter Erin to help with the expansion. Wendy approaches Carl and Anita, owners of the fledgling Big Muddy Casino, to buy them out. Marty appeals to Carl's pride and convinces him not to sell, so Wendy strikes back with a highly aggressive, emasculating sales pitch alongside Helen. Not to be outdone, Marty gets the mob to blow up the Big Muddy's primary rival, allowing Carl and Anita to back out of the deal. But Wendy has the last laugh when she and her team of strippers cheat the Big Muddy's outdated slot machines, bleeding the couple dry and strong-arming them to sell. Unfortunately, owning two casinos automatically triggers an FBI audit, completely halting Marty's laundering operations. Agent Maya Miller is put in charge of the audit, and she tempts Marty with far friendlier offers than anything Petty or Evers ever threw at him. Anita still refuses to give up the casino's adjacent hotel merely out of spite, making the Big Muddy useless. But Carl accidentally kills his wife, so that isn't too much of an issue for long. Feeling invincible, Wendy decides to rescue Zeke from Darlene. She goads the adoptive mother into punching her in the face in public for evidence in a custody hearing. Marty is freaked out by all this erratic behavior, and eavesdrops on phone calls between his wife and Navarro. Big mistake. Navarro catches on and abducts Marty during the dentist convention at the Missouri Bell, headlined by the REO Speedwagon. Well, I'm afraid for Marty, and even Speedwagon is afraid. As we should be. The cartel tortures him for days in Mexico while Helen tests Ruth's ability to run casino operations on her own. It begins well. They create a system of safe laundering through cycling a group of gambling smurfs, each losing exactly $9,000 of cartel cash a day, just enough to not trigger investigation. Agent Miller, concerned for Marty's safety, triggers a red flag on an offshore account, freezing Navarro's assets. Ruth has no idea what to do, but when Marty is presented with a problem, he fixes it in seconds, proving his worth to Navarro. Fall 2018. The whole brutally tortured thing really changes Marty. He no longer wants to run. He's now looking to take the reins of the operation back from Wendy and recruit Agent Miller. Somehow. He plans on showing his value by feeding her intel on unrelated perps through his criminal connections and financial wizardry. To gain marital leverage, Wendy also bribes the therapist in the first week of October, according to a later revealed invoice. That's how we know we've transitioned to fall. Frank Jr. is now loan sharking at the casino, so there's increased friction between him and Ruth, but at least she's dating Ben to relieve some stress. Speaking of dating, Wyatt successfully defends Darlene against Wendy during Zeke's custody hearing. They've been bonding all summer and finally consummate their bizarre relationship. Navarro has the birds invest into a horse stable, which, unbeknownst to them, houses his rival's prize stallion. It's all a ruse to neuter this horse, sending a harsh message to the rival. With all the stress, the birds crack and confess to their therapist about their cartel dealings, and are forced to bribe her even more for her silence. Ben and Ruth's relationship begins heating up, but he's unable to perform sexually. He goes off of his medication, which is a bad idea since he's already pretty freaked out with all the cartel stuff going on. He and Jonah tail Ruth to a routine mafia cash exchange. Using Jonah's drone, they see approaching vehicles and are able to warn Ruth before Laguna's cartel members wipe out the mobsters in retaliation for the horse mutilation. It's kind of a positive though. One of the victims was an FBI informant trying to date teenage Aaron. Frank Jr. blames Ruth for the slaughter of his men, so he beats the absolute crap out of her. Marty cuts off all ties with the mob, but this isn't quite enough for Ruth. She's supposed to be untouchable. She wants Frank Jr. dead. Marty doesn't want a war with the mob, so he refuses, poisoning Ruth against him. At least Ruth's assault finally reunites her with Wyatt, but Darlene's now in Ruth's ear as well. Meanwhile, Helen has the therapist killed for knowing too much. She just had to buy that sports car. Marty's had no luck turning the incorruptible Agent Miller. She simply refuses any evidence he offers, no matter how lucrative. Wendy establishes a charity organization to further expand bird influence. In the process, she uses her new political contacts to get Marty's acquired evidence in front of Maya's bosses, but this backfires when they simply demote her. Meanwhile, Ben is becoming increasingly unstable. He blames Marty and Wendy for Ruth getting the snot kicked out of her. His behavior spirals out of control until he causes a scene at the inaugural Bird Charity event. With the assassination happy Helen breathing down their necks, the birds have no choice but to commit Ben to the state mental institution. This destroys Ben, who pleads with Ruth to save him. Well, Darlene still has Sheriff Nix in her pocket, so Ben is a free man in no time. He immediately heads to Helen's house and reveals everything he knows to Aaron, signing his death warrant. Ben's just unable to keep himself out of harm's way, so Wendy is forced to drive him around aimlessly until they can figure out a place to hide him. But at every opportunity, Ben does something irrational, like telling vagrants the cartel is after him or calling Helen directly to apologize. Wendy realizes Ben is a lost cause and that she's only jeopardizing her family by letting him stick around. She calls Helen and helps orchestrate a hit on her own brother, driving her into a deep, deep depression. Darlene shoots Frank Jr. below the belt with a shotgun to fully win over the mourning Ruth, then leverages the situation to team up with the Kansas City mob. She's primed to retake control of the region's heroin business alongside the reunited Langmores. To save Agent Miller's job, Marty manipulates Sam into losing tons more money at once, triggering an audit extension. It's a good thing he did. By now, Helen has zero trust in the birds and is moving to have Navarro eliminate them. To further prove their value to Navarro, Marty takes Jonah's drone footage of the Laguna's cartel attack on the mafia to Agent Miller. She simply can't afford to turn down any more evidence. The FBI now has proof that the Laguna's cartel attacked on US soil, so they're authorized to cross the border and intervene. They essentially win Navarro's war for him, but Helen is still out for blood. As his lawyer, she forges Marty's FBI confession to finalize her assassination plan. Helen talks her way out of getting shot by a rage-fueled Jonah before joining the birds on a plane to Mexico. Marty was tipped off to the faulty confession and is prepared to die, but shockingly, it's Helen who gets her brains blown out when they arrive. So, great! With Helen out of the way, it's gonna be smooth sailing, right? The birds just need to constantly appease an unpredictable cartel head, continually fool the FBI, and not cross Darlene, the remaining Langmores, or the Kansas City mob. Well, I wish them the best of luck in season 4. Let us know what you think fate has in store for the birds in the comments, or let us know what timelines we should cover next. And make sure to subscribe to Cinematica. I'm your host, Marcus. Thanks for watching.